I had listened to a podcast a year ago on Freakonomics that had some interesting tidbits on medicine, and so I came up with this talk called Bad Medicine. So there are going to be three little parts here. First little part is evidence-based medicine and medical reversal. So, first one. Most people think that 98.6 is normal. And this is all based on some work done in the 1980s by Dr. Wunderlich, who determined that the average temperature of the human being was 98.6. And somebody at the University of Maryland he was curious as to how this was arrived at. So he was at the Modern Museum in Philadelphia, and he noticed that they had the thermometer that was used by Wunderlich in 1880, and much to his surprise, when he asked if he could see it, the curator said, well, actually, you can take it to your lab if you want to and examine it. So he was able to take it to his lab, and he looked at it, and it turns out that this is an old thermometer, but it was only used to measure axillary temperature, not the way we do temperature today. It's a foot long. It registers about 2 degrees Celsius in the current thermometer, and it needed to be read in place. So it wasn't like the thermometers today with mercury, where you take it out of the mouth and it's actually registered and you can read it. You actually have to read the temperature while it's under the person's arm. So he thought, well, maybe I should do some of my own experiments and do some testing. So he took temperature as we do today on hundreds of volunteers, males and females, and found that only 8% of the temperatures that were read actually registered in the 98.6, and the normal temperature is 98.2, what he found. And as we know now, which wasn't going back when Wunderlich was doing this, the time of day, exercise and menstrual cycle all affect the temperature. So in fact, what would appear to be a low-grade fever to some people is normal temperature for that person. There are other simple basics in medicine that were believed for a long time, which we would consider rather, how did they even arrive at that? So there was people used to believe in bloodletting to remove bad humors, or even drilling holes in a person's skull might be beneficial, or lobotomies as a treatment for mental illness, and lobotomies as a treatment existed up until the 70s. And so a lot of this medical practice, which we consider to be arcane, has been termed evidence-based medicine, as opposed to evidence-based medicine, which I'll get to. So evidence-based medicine is really a medical practice that was driven by kind of charismatic people in medicine. So if somebody was well-known in medicine and proposed something, a lot of people did that because, well, this person knows what he's doing. He's got white hair, practicing for many years. He must know a lot. So if he says lobotomies work, lobotomies it is. If bloodletting works, bloodletting, that's what they do. So a lot of it was based on anecdotes or preconceived notions. There was no actual science to what was being done. So you have what people now term evidence-based medicine, which I think is a very good play on words, because now we're into the era of evidence-based medicine, which is based on randomized controlled trials, and at least over the past couple of decades, the use of computers and computer technology allows the analysis of a lot of this data that's being generated by clinical trials to come up with good conclusions and data analysis. And a lot of this is due to this one individual, Sir Ian Chalmers in England. He was the first director of the National Perinatal Epidemiology Unit in Oxford. He developed the Oxford Database of Prenatal Trials. In the late 1980s, he wrote edited a two-volume book on the effective care of pregnancy and childbirth. And he was one of the founders of something called the Cochrane Collaboration. And this is from the website of the Cochrane Collaboration. And as you can see up in the corner, it's trusted evidence, informed decisions, and better health. And it's a British nonprofit organization. They have developed a way of doing systematic reviews of all the randomized controlled trials about healthcare interventions. And these reviews are published online at the Cochrane Library. So if you're interested in drugs and random trials, go to the Cochrane Library, and if they've done a review, it's published there and searchable. And it's a really nice data set if you're interested in following up on clinical trials. His work led to something that's now being called medical reversal. Here's a book here written by this author. I think this is published in 2013, calling Ending Medical Reversals. But he, at the end, I'll have a reference on an article he published about medical reversals. What this is with the randomized trial, actually tested whether what you believe for this case is being beneficial, whether that actually is true. You have a medical reversal occur when the randomized trial says it contradicts what you assumed was the benefit and there is no benefit. So, and also it uncovers some unperceived side effects, and the end result, what you believe for a long time, has been reversed. And so this is the term where the term medical reversal comes from. A couple of examples of this. So this is a study I wasn't aware of. Maybe some people in the audience are. It's called the CAS study. And this was for cardiac arrhythmia suppression trial. So the postulation was, well, after people have a heart attack, maybe as a benefit, we should give them drugs that prevent arrhythmias. And the drug would reduce arrhythmias and maybe increase survival post operation for the heart attack. But a randomized trial showed that, in fact, this approach decreased survival, did not increase survival, and therefore contradicted what most doctors assumed was a very plausible approach, that you would have a heart attack, give them a drug that will suppress arrhythmias. This seems like a good, plausible approach to improve survival after the heart attack, when in fact, that isn't what happened. But no one really looked at that until someone did a randomized trial. Everybody went along with the eminence type of medicine. The other would have been estrogen supplements for postmenopausal women. So in the 1990s, women before menopause had lower right rates of heart disease, so therefore, postmenopausal, it was thought, well, if you give them some estrogen supplements, it would maybe improve or lower the risk for heart disease. Finally, in 2002, there was a randomized trial that seemed to not validate this postulated benefit, and in fact, looking at the studies, one could maybe say that there was an increased risk for heart attacks and strokes in women, postmenopausal women, who would be giving estrogen in the hope of actually helping their health. In fact, it was not helping their health. So again, it's another, what seems like a plausible approach, but it never really been tested. It was just, seems plausible, let's do it. If drugs and drug trials and tribulations. So thalidomide, most of you in the audience have heard about thalidomide, and some of you about my age remember thalidomide. And so this was developed by a company in Germany. It was a sedative, not a barbiturate. It was not addictive. It was not affected by whether the person was doing alcohol or had other contraindicated drugs. It was also found to combat morning sickness in pregnant women. One of the key things here is, no matter how much of this drug they gave to rats, they couldn't do any damage to the rat. There was no dose that they could give that was detrimental to the health of the rat. So everybody just assumed it would be a great drug to give, particularly to women who had morning sickness. Well, it turns out thalidomide crosses the placenta. It caused malformations and fetal death. It was on the market for 5 years before somebody started to notice and compile the information. Estimated that about 7,000 children were born with birth defects. Estimated that over 10,000 fetal deaths resulted from the administering of thalidomide to women, pregnant women who may have been experiencing morning sickness. And this actually is a mild form. Some of you may, I certainly do remember this picture from the papers in the 60s of all of these children in Europe that had been exposed to thalidomide, and they had classes for these children, and they were learning how to write with shortened arms. And it turns out in the United States didn't have this problem, even though there were over 1 million tablets distributed throughout the United States by the subsidiary of the German drug company. It never was approved by the FDA, because this person, Dr. Francis Kelsey, looked at the application and did not believe it offered a complete and compelling evidence to support the safety of administering this drug. So she never gave FDA approval, and those tablets were never really distributed in the United States as it had been in England and the other European countries. So in the United States, even though we became aware and thalidomide was in the papers and in the headlines, we didn't have this issue of a lot of children being born like this. Now, the after effect of this, I wasn't aware of. So the thalidomide, because of this, then FDA established stringent rules for drug approval called the Kefauver-Harris Act. And the FDA suggested that women should not be included in clinical trials because of potential adverse effects in the field. Because of the thalidomide, we now have trials, if they are starting to occur, are not including women as a portion of the population in the clinical trials because of this potential effect on the fetus. But before we leave thalidomide, there has been what I call rehabilitation. So in 1964, just by chance, there was a patient with leprosy who was given thalidomide because all of the painkillers and sedatives were not effective in alleviating the discomfort of this patient. And he was given thalidomide, and not only did it work as a painkiller, it reduced the other symptoms. With that finding, there were some other trials done. So in 1967, the World Health Organization had a clinical trial that showed that there were actually positive effects by administering thalidomide. And then the FDA has approved it as a chemotherapeutic agent for patients with multiple myeloma. So thalidomide is coming back, but there's still a restriction on its who gets thalidomide, and it's restricted as to how it's used as an agent. About this same time, actually over a longer stretch of time, there was DES, which again, some people in the audience may remember that. Because in my mother's generation, a lot of the women were given this compound. This is an estrogenic compound, again, prescribed to pregnant women to prevent miscarriage. This was the thought. Cause miscarriage was thought in some cases to be due to a low level estrogen. So this is an estrogenic agent. So again, a plausible thing. We're giving a little bit more estrogen during pregnancy, maybe help prevent miscarriage. And it was given for a long period of time, from 1938 to 1971. But in fact, in 1953, there was already evidence that it was not effective in actually in preventing the miscarriage, which is what you're giving the women this drug for. And then it became apparent that there were actually side effects giving this drug to the fetus of the mother who took this. So you now had young girls and women who had a rare vaginal cancer in 1971. There was an increased risk of breast cancer for those women who were born to women who had taken DES. They have an increased risk for breast cancer. It's risk to males. It's not clear. There are some studies that indicate there's testicular abnormalities and some that don't so that I know that for women my age who were born to women who took DES, there was all appeared to be, for a while, thought to be an increase in endometriosis, which had an impact on their fertility, their ability to conceive. So in 1977, you already had the FDA restricting the inclusion of women to some degree, but in 77, because of DES on top of the thalidomide, the FDA recommended excluding from early clinical trials, that's phase one, phase two, premenopausal females capable of becoming pregnant. So now, as a result of this, starting in 1977, 50% of the population was excluded from phase one and phase two clinical trials. So what you have now, a lot of the clinical trials are using only men. So they have no clue what the effect is on women. This is an example of this. Ambien or Zolpidem. 60 million prescriptions each year for sleeping pills. We seem to be addicted to sleeping pills, and you probably, if you watch TV, anytime during the day, there's some ad for some new sleeping pill, and I think Ambien's into its third generation. I think there's Ambien Extended, I don't know, something like that. 66% of sleeping pills contain this agent. When Ambien came on the market, the drug maker did know that there was a difference in gender metabolism of the drug, but that didn't sort of pay, nobody paid attention to that. They only studied the efficacy in males. No females were ever included in that study. But in fact, liver enzymes, and I'll show you in the next two slides, have different activities depending on the gender. So in fact, Ambien is not cleared by females at the same rate as males. It's cleared slower. So when someone finally did a study, 8 hours after taking Ambien, and you're told to, if you take Ambien, don't operate heavy equipment, don't drive for 6 to 8 hours. Well, at 8 hours, 10 to 15% of women still have enough Ambien in their system to be impaired enough to drive in the mailboxes, sleepwalk, all of this stuff that it shouldn't have been happening, and only 3% of men have this level. I know, it was a first-hand story, I know of a woman who took Ambien on a plane trip across to Europe, and she had a connecting flight. Unfortunately, she was traveling with somebody else, but she has no recollection of how she got from the flight that landed to the next connecting flight, because she'd taken Ambien and the person just guided her because she had never cleared. She was still drowsy, had no clue. She had not been driving with flying with someone, she could have still been on the plane. So here's a table I pulled from an article on liver enzymes. And so these are phase one enzymes. These are the CYP450 enzymes that are involved in hepatic clearance of metabolism of certain enzymes, or certain drugs, I should say. And you can see, so for this 1A1, the enzyme activity in men is greater than women. Here are the examples of the drugs and the other characteristics. And you see, but 2A6, it's women have greater activity than men. 2B6, women greater than men. 2C9, 2C19, men and women are somewhat equal. But you see there's a difference based on the gender. The phase 2 enzymes add a side chain or some other molecule to the drug in order to help its clearance by the renal system. And here again, you see, depending on the transferase, whether the men have a higher enzyme activity than women. So, in fact, the gender is an important factor, not only for pharmacokinetics, but for other things. So I'm not sure how much we pay attention to that when we're starting to think about, I raise this because we're talking about treating autism and everything, but I wonder if we shouldn't also be paying attention to whether the sex of the child and how they're responding, and pay attention in terms of the treatment. So, follow-up to the Andean and other studies, in 1993, Congress required women be included in all late-stage clinical trials funded by NIH unless the drug is only for men. So now we're coming back to including women. But when the drug companies do their drug testing in the animals, there's nothing said about including males and females in rats or mice. So most likely, a lot of times, they're only looking at the male animals because the females have these other issues. And they want a uniform population to deal with when they're looking at clinical trials. 2016, as most a lot of us are aware of, they tried to do grants. NIH stated all studies had to include gender as part of the study. You have to be including females in part of your study. If you look at clinical trials, and the people at the Cochrane and other places have done, the companies tend to be selective in how they do their clinical trials. So on average, patients are 10 years younger. Not, it says real, but it's real-life patients. Okay. So that means what the doctor is seeing, those patients aren't necessarily being represented in the drug trial that the company is running. They're using younger patients as possible because they're going to be a little bit in better health than someone who's 10, 20 years older. But those people are going to have a different, may have a different response. Sometimes only 6% of the patients with a condition actually would qualify based on the stringent inclusion requirements of the drug company. And one of the examples was there was an ad testing for asthma, something as simple as asthma. When the person looked at what were the inclusion criteria for the drug trial, only 10% of his patients were to qualify because in the real world, his patients are older or are on other drugs or some other thing that may impact the efficacy of that drug. So, in fact, a lot of times there's no improvement in the real life patient, even though the drug company says, I saw this improvement, but you have to look at what their population was. Cancer drugs, for example. The majority of the new drugs offer a very limited gain. So one study found of 71 drugs for solid cancers, the median improvement of survival was 2.1 months. Now this sounds good if the survival is only 6 months, but it isn't all that good if it's a couple of years and you're only improving it 2.1 months. I mean, you have to keep that in mind. And these treatments are not cheap. They're $100,000 a year, even with these drugs, and you have very little improvement. Drugs for diabetes. A lot of the recently approved drugs definitely reduce the level of blood sugar, the level of sugar in the blood, but almost none reduce the risk of the heart attack, the renal failure, or the eye problems that you see in diabetics. So the question is, coming back to what Walter mentioned before, so was the proper outcome chosen for the trial? I mean, if you're trying to lower blood sugar, oh, that's a great outcome. But if you're really trying to say this drug is going to help long term, there is no improvement. So the drug is improving blood sugar level, but had no effect on the other problems associated with diabetes that actually put you at risk of a heart attack, the renal failure, or retinopathy. And last, drilled by pain or pills. So this gets to the opioid epidemic at the moment. So why pain? Well, there was a push in the 80s and 90s to recognize and treat pain. What did this mean? That there was a promotion that pain become the fifth vital sign, along with temperature, blood pressure, pulse, and BPM. So pain of all of these, the pain is only the only subjective measure. All of those, the doctor actually gets a figure for it. There's some way he can measure that. Pain is the patient's assessment. The doctor says, well, how's your pain? Scale of 10. Nowadays, they have you pick a emoji. You know, does your face look like this? Are you smiling? Happy? Is it tears coming out of you? It's all emoji based, but it's a patient's assessment. And that people have different pain tolerance. And by 2015, 650,000 opioid prescriptions were written per day in the United States. There's actually, I'm calling this the perfect storm of painkillers. So since the early 2000s, prescription drugs started to appear on TV. Before then, they were non-existent. I'm not sure why all of a sudden drug companies were allowed to advertise on TV. And actually nowadays, if you listen to the, probably because of some other regulation, if you listen to the ads, they have all these caveats that you wonder who actually can take this medicine, because they have so many, if you have this, this, or this, don't take this. But they're still going to ask their doctor for it because they saw it on TV and that person looked very happy after they took that drug. Pain management is expensive. And you can go to pain management clinics and it's a whole team that's trying to address the issue. But it's cheaper if the doctor can write a drug prescription for something you get filled. That's typically with, come down on insurance companies. The insurance companies are more likely to pay for the drug than they are for the pain management. Patients wanted painkillers from their doctors. They feel better if they got in and the doctor wrote a prescription for a painkiller rather than the doctor saying, take 2 aspirin and call me in the morning. Someone in the audience even told me an anecdote about how as a pediatrician, you would lose some patients when the child had a cold, and it was probably the flu, and they wanted a prescription for an antibiotic, and give them a prescription for an antibiotic and show them what the Kleenex was like and just have them blow their nose and they'll be over it. Some of those families never came back because they didn't leave with a prescription for the antibiotic. Something similar. So, and there's also been this focus on patient satisfaction. I'm not knocking that, but this patient satisfaction, this focus on patients filling out the questions, how do you rate your doctor? You go online, do a search for dermatologist in town, and they give you a rating. It's all based on patient information. Some studies have shown that physicians who did not comply with patient requests sometimes received a poor rating. So doctors are sort of aware of this, so they may be more amenable to writing that prescription for the painkiller. But interestingly, a study recently showed that satisfied patients actually have a higher rate of hospitalization and mortality. And in part, it's because, this is a little bit of that defensive medicine, but the patients, they feel better if the doctor hospitalized them, ordered all these tests, then they're satisfied. Or if they're in a hospital, they're satisfied because they got the pain medicine at the right time. But in fact, when you do the controlled studies, they actually have higher rates of hospitalization and mortality. So are they really healthy? And that's the end of my little talk here. The references are here. Some of them obviously are not easy reads, like ending medical reversal. This would be an interesting indicator reversal analysis of 146 contraindicated medical practices. And this heart study would be of interest. So, thank you.